Closet Podcast. I am Dr. Sam, and with me, Dr. Robert. How are you?
Hey guys, how's everybody doing?
How are you doing?
You know, it's controlled chaos at this household right now. So.
Right now, I know, especially. Yes. The kitties all running around.
Yes, they're nudging the computer as we speak, so they're being a great help. Briny, come here. Anyway, how has your week been so far?
A little bit thrown back into the frying pan because I was gone, and so I'm tired right now, but today's my day off, and so usually my day off is like I have a little bit more time to get stuff done, but now the kids are home for the summer, so it's like, oh yeah, right, now I got to figure out how to do things and have them here and all that stuff, so it's a little,
it's so much
different.
Harder.
Yeah, it's a little different. I mean, it's good because, like, so but the other days, like, we have a nanny, but like this is the day that we always give her off because I'm home and I want to spend time with them, and so it's like, oh, you know, and that's just in the summer, obviously, but like,
yeah.
So, but then also too, like, their schedules are like everywhere. It's like, because it, I don't know, growing up, I always had like a camp that I did all summer or something like that. And they don't have that. It's like, this week we're doing this, this next week we're doing this, this week we're doing this, but only for 2 hours. And then the 2 weeks from now, we're going to be at farm camp all day. You know what I mean? Like, it's not like one whole thing all summer. I don't know. Was that how it was for you? Or is that,
I feel like I truly appreciate now what my parents did for me, because I know like how much running around they did. Mm-hmm. So I definitely appreciate that part of things. Yeah, I think there's just so much going on these days. Like, everybody wants you in like six sports, and you've got to do this camp and that camp. And also, it's expensive. My sister's trying to do it right now, and camp is ridiculously expensive.
Yeah, I mean, there's a reason that the week that we have farm camp for all three kids, I was like, well, since we're going to be in camp all day, I don't think we need our nanny to come.
Exactly. It's like,
it's just too much. Yeah.
No,
just
so much.
Everything is so expensive. And like, even just like they were doing like just like tennis or something, you know what I mean? It's like, it's so an extra thing you got to pay. You know what I mean? It's just like, it's so much. So, but they enjoy it and they love it, and I want them to have the experiences. So, you know, you find a way to do it if you can, but it's definitely a lot, you know. It just, the summers are a whole thing. So that's,
yeah, I really appreciate my parents for everything they did, because I don't tell them that enough. I probably never will, but it's a lot. So credit to you for doing all the things that parents have to do. It's not easy.
Oh, I'm sure your parents are just proud of you and all the wonderful things you're doing. And that brings me to the topic of today.
What is that topic, Dr. Sam?
Well, so today we're sort of talking about mental health, and it's an important thing to check in on every once in a while. I mean, I think we've sort of talked about it before. And it's not the first time we'll talk about it. It's certainly not the last time. But sort of the thing that triggered this one today was we were having a meeting. For those of you, obviously anybody who's listening knows my Balto exists and that we have meetings and that we do things to try to really get this thing going. And we talk so much about the reason that we do it, right? Because it's to save pets' lives. To really give people a lifeline when they can't afford care. And that really speaks to two of the three prongs of the things that we're doing, right? So we're trying to save pets. We're trying to help alleviate economic euthanasias, which, you know, is something that is so heartbreaking for people, owners of pets. But it's really, really heartbreaking for veterinarians. And veterinarians, again, if you listen to this podcast, it's not a mystery, right? We are suffering. I mean, a lot of veterinarians are either more at risk for suicide than the average bear, you know, you have the average American, right? But yeah, it's actually not just Americans. I was reading an article today, and it's inherent more so in like the field of veterinary medicine. So even in other countries, like we're even seeing it in,
oh really,
the UK, in Australia. Yeah, I was reading an AVMA article just sort of like looking at it to see if it was like an American phenomenon, like are we just like working ourselves crazy, or is it inherent in like what we do, what we've chosen to do for a living? And it looks to be that it is. It's inherent in the practice of veterinary medicine. And I think that people don't realize the economic, I mean, not the economic, the emotional toll that it takes on us every day. I mean, so many different situations. And so I was like, well, I think it'd be interesting to maybe kind of explore some of those things. And I don't have any sort of like specific agenda today, except just to kind of like let people understand what it's like for us to be veterinarians and where that happens for some people, especially people who struggle with mental illness.
Yeah, I think that's a great thing for it, because I think there's like, just like anything, there's a lot of factors that go into it. It's like, most of it's not even just your personal life. It's, the things we do at work and trying to balance all those things on a daily basis. And I mean, God, even being a parent alone, I think that's stressful enough. So trying to add that to a veterinary career, I think it just, and it's kind of an emphasis, the fact that like this is a difficult job because of what you mentioned. Like, it's not just present in the US. Like, the US is known for having not the greatest work conditions, right? We suck with but maternity leave and maternity leave for people. We don't give the greatest benefits in terms of whether it's healthcare versus, we demand minimal PTO from people. It's like you get 2 weeks off a year, which other countries are like, hey, take off a full month to go explore. So we really don't have those things. I think to say that other countries also say the same thing in their veterinary industry speaks a lot to the stresses that just go on to on a day-to-day basis.
I think what's so interesting about that is that, like, yeah, there is so much to the way that we have structured our work-life balance, right? As a country, as people who work. Even just seeing, like, my brother-in-law being an expat, like, he worked in for an American company in Germany, and, like, it is very different, and they have a different point of view. Like, some of them are like, we wish we could work more. You know what I mean? So it's like, yeah, there has to be a balance in there somewhere, right? But like, but yeah, there, but we definitely seem to be starting to talk more about work-life balance. Like, I think it, and it's hard because I think it's like anything else, is going to take a generation of change, right? Because, like, a lot of the, like, baby boomers that were the practice owners that are the ones that worked themselves silly for, like, I mean, like, the owner of my practice, I think he had a plot of land, he had a trailer basically, and people were coming in, and he just saw every patient six, maybe 7 days a week, I don't even know, but at least 6 days a week by himself, built the practice. I mean, obviously it's brick and mortar now, and he figured it out. It was before, like, the world got built around him, and now there's a Costco and a Target across the street. But, like, so we come in and we're like, we don't see that part of the struggle. But there was a few different things happening at that time versus what's happening at this time. And I do think some of it is part of where we see the struggle. And one of the things is, I think I've told you this before. I don't know if I've said it on the podcast or not, but, like, his sort of philosophy is like, you just by being there, just by, like, helping the animal with what you've already done so much. Like, you've already done so much, so you should just feel good about that. And I wish that I could take what he says and sort of be like, yeah, that's right, I did. But I have only ever been a doctor in the age of the ability to refer things to specialists. I've only ever been in, a doctor in the time of Google. I've only been a doctor in the time of, things that, there's a shift in the way the owners and, like, the way they kind of come to doctors and, like, want their opinion on things or challenge what they think we think. You know what I mean? Like, they almost say, like, well, I looked on Google for 10 minutes, so
Yeah,
I
Google's a
know.
nightmare.
And it's like, well, I went to school, and, like, I actually know. But, like, you know what I mean? So I do think that there is, like, we've kind of come at it from two very different places. I mean, because there was a time where doctors, like, didn't have the option to have these big secondary hospitals where, like, you work at a referral hospital. I mean, that used to not even exist, right? So, like, your GP, your local vet, just winging it was the best you had. And people were appreciative of whatever you could do. And there was really no question of anything else. And now you almost feel like if you can't give the Cadillac to everybody that comes, you feel guilty. If you don't know exactly what's going on, you feel guilty. If you don't, you know what I mean? So at least for me, I mean, that's a big part of where I struggle as a veterinarian. And I don't know if that's just, like, me, but I don't think so, because I do seem to see that's something that I hear from other people.
No, absolutely. I think you mentioned both sides. It's really both sides of the equation. They're different now than when your boss started. The growing human animal bond is a big part of that. Like, we are more attached to our animals than we ever have been before. We are making the jokes that millennials are not having you know, kids anymore, they're having pets. And that's because one, they love them just as much and they want the same care that they're providing themselves to their pet. And so that also then demands a higher level of excellence from us as veterinarians. And that's just a lot of pressure because, and I mean, honestly, we're more litigious than we have been.
Yeah.
As well. Like people are like, if we screw up, there's a stress to it now because we don't want to screw up. We are trying our best to like give your pet the best care we can, but accidents happen. And if that happens, like,
but even sometimes I think the worst part about it is like, it's not even an accident. It's just a bad outcome. Like,
yeah,
that's life. I mean, you're not God. You can't wave a magic wand. And to boot, your patient can't tell you what's wrong with them. So, I mean, you can follow, you can sleuth it out the best you can, but ultimately, I mean, I can't tell you how, probably still one of the things I struggle with the most as a veterinarian is like those cases that you're like, I still don't know what the hell was wrong with that dog. Like I, you know what I mean? Like, and I mean, I did every test like that I was possibly able to do within my world, you know?
Yeah.
And I've even had those ones that I've referred out and even, you know, Purdue doesn't know why, you know what I mean? And they have all the bells and whistles, they have everything and we still don't know why. And sometimes there's something we can do about it. Like sometimes they'll respond to symptomatic care and sometimes they won't. Now, I mean, more often than not, if they go to that level, we get some sort of an answer, but there are those ones where we don't. And I have a really hard time separating, but like any time I see one of those cases, like coming at me, I'm like, I'm going to try to prepare you for this, but I don't know if I can. And I can't just like walk out of the room and drop that. Cause I genuinely in that, yeah. I feel how these people feel. I've been through the diagnostic process. So I really understand both like human, like I have had a mystery disease I couldn't figure out for 2 years. And I've also been the doctor trying to figure that out with people. And so like, I genuinely like feel this every time I go into one of these rooms when I'm, you know, going in and euthanizing. Like I just euthanized a dog the other day that I've been caring for years. And I was like, so sad. I mean, like, and they were so sad and we were all crying together. So it's like, I can see where if you are not at a place where you don't have, you know, some sort of something, you know what I mean? Like a family or your faith or whatever the thing is that grounds you when you finally leave it. I think I can see where that really comes in for some people who don't have that support, who don't have that, you know?
Absolutely. I think just not having that support system is a big part of it. And it differed, like to add emphasis to like some of this conversation. It's not just like mental health and, you know, feeling sad about our days. It's costing lives. Veterinarians have an extremely high suicide rate. We used to be the highest. I don't think we are anymore, but I think we're right up there with,
I think we're like the second highest now.
Yeah. I think police officers are up there too. Like it's a very high, but that's not an award you want to win. You don't want to be in the top five for that one. Uh-uh. And a lot of it just comes down to even nowadays. I mean, I think something that's harder for me is just how, when we do try our best or just how owners respond to some things we do. Like I had an owner throw a clipboard at my technician once. I'm sorry, like that's not okay on any level ever. Or any platform. But it's that kind of stuff that you see on a regular basis that's just like, what, like treating people with respect. And I think we've lost some of that with social media too, so I think that plays a role in it.
Yes, and I was actually going to say that too, is like the trashing of the veterinarian on social media. I saw so like I'm on you know that list with all the moms, right? Like and the thing is that like there's times where they'll, somebody will say like, hey, we're being attacked right now, you know? And I mean, and it's like, you can't even believe the vitriol. I mean, people are like, they should die. They should, you know, and it's like, you don't understand these people. Like this is their livelihood. They have dedicated their life to try to help your animal. And I mean, if you had a bad outcome or you didn't like the doctor, okay, move on with your day. Yeah. You know what I mean? And also if you lost your pet, that is tragic. It's very tragic. And there is a time and a place for being angry too. I mean, that is part of your grieving. That's fair. But like, you shouldn't destroy a person's life and a person's
Their character. Yeah. Like, cause you don't know the whole story. And that goes for us as well. Like, you know, we always don't know all of it and it goes on. We don't know your life story, but at the same time, I think most veterinarians do a pretty good job of treating people with respect until and there's like I'm sure there's a couple that have like lost gone off the handle after being yelled at and they're just like, hey, I'm done with this.
Right.
But just that level of respect, I think just across everything has
right.
really gone downhill. I think people think there's no repercussions for saying stuff online because they don't like face the person they're saying. You
oh,
just
yeah,
type something
absolutely.
And you just, you're like, yeah, I can say these things. It's tough. It's because you read those things. Like I've been in the middle of the night in my clinic where I've seen my technicians like on the computer at night because they have a couple of down meds and they're looking at reviews of the hospital and they're not looking for the good ones. They're looking
Right.
for the ones like our worst reviews and they're tough to read sometimes. Just like
Oh,
people
yeah.
will say, and it's just like, so yeah, it's, I think it's taxing from that side of things. And I don't
Oh,
know. And then the
it is,
finances.
especially when you see like a review or something from somebody that you were like, I spent like an hour with the person. Like I thought I did, you know what I mean? Like I tried my best. Like I did, you know what I mean? And you know, it's a pretty rare day that you have somebody that's A, not really competent. That I think for the most part, there's not that many vet schools. So to get into a vet school, you have to have two brain cells at least that are working, and you had to have made it through a very grueling thing. Like there's not a lot of veterinarians that like aren't competent, you know, and I'm sure there are some, right? There are some for sure. But like for the most part, they're there because they want to help. They're not perfect. And they might not even be your cup of tea. Like I might not be everybody's cup of tea, and that's fine. But that doesn't mean like you need to destroy me, you know what I'm saying, or something like that, or some other person, you know, if they don't jive with you in some way. And I have seen, thankfully I've not personally ever been attacked on like a review. I mean, I've never had anything like that. But I mean, I've had somebody say like, I don't know, some guy came in with a very aggressive dog, and I was like told him not to breed his dog, and he was angry with that, which is fine.
That's
No problem with
that's
that.
such fine.
That's
It's like,
cool. Like I'm cool with that. But like but I think that might be the only one. But I have seen, I mean, some horrible things about people who I know are good people, like good doctors. Good, you know what
yeah.
I mean? And I'm like, come on. I also saw recently somebody was bashing a vet for like redoing their hospital, like making it look nice. And they basically were like, oh, well, we all know that you don't do anything unless it helps your bottom line. And you just look at this beautiful clinic you work in. And it's like, are you kidding me? Like, first off, you probably wouldn't even want to walk through the door if it didn't look nice. Number one. Number two,
Yeah.
why shouldn't they work in a nice place? If you don't want to go there, then don't go there. If you think it's overpriced, don't go there. No one's forcing you to do it. There's
Yeah.
no, nobody owes you a vet care or a pet like that, you know what I'm saying? Like I it's
Yeah.
bizarre. I don't understand that at all.
That's rough because it's like you're trying to better yourself and better your clinics, your employees are a better place to work, your clients enjoy the waiting room. Because like I can speak from experience in terms of like my college undergrad experience. When I played on the soccer team, the away locker room was a dungeon. And we liked
On
it that way
purpose.
because it
Yeah.
demoralized them. So it was fine. We were fine with it. But like if my but when I was in those separate rooms, it was horrible. It's like I feel like I'm gonna get MRSA just by walking in this place.
Yeah, that
So like,
ringworm.
yeah, ringworm, like anything like that. So trying to make the place look better is just tough. And I think some people are just looking to pick fights and I even had a colleague at my hospital. A woman went to the exam room with him, had her phone on, had the phone pointed at him. He didn't know about it, and was purposely trying to trap him the entire time so she could record it and put it on social media later. And she actually did. And then, unfortunately, the organization she was working with did not approve of her actions and they took care of it for us. But it's just like,
Wow.
why are you trying to cause problems?
But what was he trying to, what was she trying to catch him doing?
He had recommended that potentially removing the pet's limb because there was a very significant injury where he's like, I don't think, you know, and potentially like, and quality of life is a conversation we can have. But he's like, it took me just a very expensive surgery to fix this and your dog may not be able to walk. So it's just like a complicated thing. And he brought up the issue of quality of life. And he's like, oh, well, all you vets want to do is euthanize. And it's just, anyway,
Yeah. And
it's
that
just
is,
stuff like that.
do you think that that's part of it though too? Is how often we do see euthanasias and perform them, that that's where the like that there's like a comfort to ending suffering, and that's any correlation to why the suicide rate is higher, do you think?
I don't know. It's a good question. I don't have a good answer for it right now. I think something my girlfriend asked me the other day was, do I have a hard time with all the euthanasias I've done? Because I've done more than most. Just working in the ER, you tend to do more just by the very nature of things. You know, obviously we don't get as attached because we don't know them for maybe the length of time that, you know, our general practitioners do.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's not easy. I think religion plays a role into it somewhat for me. It's like, will God forgive me one day for all the lives I've ended? And usually for good reason, but some of them, it's like a two-year-old. I euthanized a two-year-old husky 2 weeks ago. That wasn't fun. That was horrible.
Why didn't you adopt it? I can't believe you didn't just take it home.
If I didn't have 16 cats. Yeah, I was like, if I didn't have 16 cats right now, it would have been a conversation.
Yeah, right.
But he was a beautiful dog. He was, you know, 60 pounds, handsome, and probably had a foreign body, honestly. And something that's, he was sick. Like, he was real sick. But it was a chance, though. And so it's, so those type of cases that keep you up and you're like, you look for forgiveness one day, or the ones that keep you up and add to your stress.
Right.
So I don't know. What are your thoughts on that particular question?
I do think that for some people, depending on, you brought up religion. So I think depending on like how you feel about a suicide to begin with, right? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't necessarily equate euthanasia in animals to be the same thing as what happens with people. I don't think they're the same. So, not to get too into the weeds about that, but like, but I do think that there's a difference. And I have never, that I can think of, done a convenience euthanasia, nor would I, right? Like, I would never euthanize an animal if it were in my power in any way that wasn't either dying slowly and suffering or about to like eat a baby's face off. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so there, I think aggressive animals that are a danger to people should be euthanized in certain situations if they can't be kept safe. I have a hair that's sticking up. It's driving me nuts and I can't see it right now. Sorry. I keep like picking at it. I'm like, where is it going? But anyway, and so I will say that it takes a toll on me, but not in like a, I don't think it's morally wrong, right? Like, I think we took a vow as veterinarians to end suffering. And sometimes suffering looks very different to different people. Mm-hmm. And I have to accept an owner's idea of their dog's quality of life at a certain level. And sometimes also just what I know of a disease process informs what I know is going to happen to the animal. So they don't need, in my opinion, to be like totally down and out before I'll, you know, euthanize. So for me, and I think, but I do think that there are some people that truly believe like that's the way you end all suffering. And so I do think in some cases, I do think it makes it a little easier, just our access to the meds and just how commonplace it is. And I think if you're hurting that badly, it seems like a good out, you know what I mean? Like if you're really, you know, and that's one of the things that I was reading in the article was saying that like the reason that, so when you compare like the mental health issues and the suicide rate, but if you look at attempted suicides, they're actually lower in veterinarians, and it's because they're actually successful more often than not, which is horrible. So an awful thought, right?
Yeah. I mean, unfortunately we have access to drugs that allow us to do that, which is the hard part. And I think it's the way around. I'll say I thought statistically men are actually better at suicide than women. Not that it's something that's a good thing to be proud of.
No.
But
women actually are more likely to do it, and there's more women veterinarians. And that was actually the other thing I was gonna say, is I do think the number of female veterinarians, because women are just more likely to commit suicide than men.
Yeah.
It's awful.
It's horrible. And there's a lot of great organizations out there that are trying to bring attention to this, and Not One More Vet. If you ever see NOMV, it stands for Not One More Vet. They're a great organization that really tries to help, you know, spread the word about the mental health issue and suicide in veterinarians. There's also the hospital that we're working with my Balto. They're doing really, it's animal ER care out in Colorado. I encourage you to take a look, donate to their cause. They're really, and really to the base of what Sam and I are doing is, part of these conversations are because of financial conversations. It's that constant day-to-day. Like, I honestly, there's not many conversations I have that don't involve money at some point, especially over the last 6 months. Yep. Like things are more expensive than they ever have been. And we'll talk about that maybe on another episode, like why things have gotten so expensive.
Right.
But it's just taxing and it wears on you after a while. And eventually, like, yeah, it adds to your mental health. And so I really appreciate what Animal ER Care is doing. They're really trying to spread awareness about it and hopefully ease some of that. One of the biggest pain points we have, which is the financial capacity for owners to pay for their pet's care. So we can help with that. We can do a lot of cool things.
Yeah, and I do hope that over time people do realize like the benefit of maybe not being in that situation to like maybe consider insurance and stuff like that, just so that we're not in this not having this come. I mean, there'll always be this conversation because there'll always be surgeries that are just really expensive or things that pop up that maybe don't get covered or something like that. Like there's more than one part of this conversation, but yeah, the financial part I think is wearing on everybody. And it's hard for me. I mean, cause like we are constantly stuck between either wanting to do things for free, which I can't do. I can't work the amount that I work and spend the amount of time away from my family and not be compensated for it. I can't do that, you know?
And no one does that either. I think it's what's ridiculous about it. It's like people have jobs, they get paid to do their jobs.
Right.
This is our job.
Right.
We should be paid to do our job. And just because ours involves lives and maybe to a more serious nature doesn't mean we shouldn't be compensated for it because we spend a lot of time going to school. We have a very high debt to income ratio.
Yep.
People don't realize that. They think, oh, you're a doctor, you make a lot of money. No, a lot of our colleagues, even you and I talked about it at a conference recently.
Yep.
One of our colleagues was making like 60 or 70 grand a year for a while with literally close to $500,000 in loans.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I'm sorry.
She'll never pay that off. Right.
Yeah. You're not paying that off.
Yeah.
So it's not what everybody thinks in terms of like, yes, you're a doctor. We are not the same type of doctors. Very different.
The thing that's hard is that it's not that we don't do a lot of the same things. It's just we don't get compensated the same way. We work many, many hours and we do a lot of things outside of the time of like when we're just in the office. That's not. And I think for me, like, and I can say, you know, one of the last things that I'll say about like what's so stressful for me is the amount of record keeping that we have to do is staggering, hours of work that we are not compensated for. And so people a lot of times will be like, oh, can't you just see my dog for 5 minutes? And it's like, nothing is ever 5 minutes. Like that is adding a lot of time. And you know what I'm saying? And you know, and again, I have three children. Like I do actually want to see them and spend time with them. And so, you know, it's hard because I really love clinical medicine. Like I really do. I really enjoy it. I love going in. I love teaching people. I love like talking to owners. I love growing with the puppies and like that stuff. If like I could do that and there was none of the other stuff, then I think we would have the most perfect jobs in the world. And I don't think we would have the suicide rate that we do. But because it comes along with a lot of the negative things, I mean, you know, and if it was just the paperwork, if that was the worst negative we had, okay, you know, but then there is also the stress of like, you were all type A personality people. And if I don't have, like, if I don't think I did a good job on something, even if I feel like I did a great job, I'll still sit there and worry about it. Like, well, but how's it going to heal? How is it going to, you know what I mean? Like, you know, and so we also have some, that's our own fault. Like, that's my own fault. Like, I know that that's just like, I have to get better at dealing with that sort of stress, but we all are perfectionists too. And I think there's a certain personality type that goes to become veterinarians. And that also may be part of the issue as well.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I think the personality types are a big part of that. So we're all type A is a very big deal.
Yeah. Self-selecting group. So we all became veterinarians, you know, so.
Yes, we did. And it's a fun time, but it's worth it. Okay. Big question. Would you do it all over again?
Oh, I think I would. I mean, I really do love being a veterinarian. I don't know what else I would be doing. You know what I mean? Like I really do cherish like a lot of the experiences that I've had and the people that I've met because of going to vet school. So I do, I think I would you do it again?
I think so, but I wouldn't have my kids do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I wouldn't tell them to be a veterinarian because if you like medicine, go be a human doctor.
Yeah. Although I'll be honest with you, my whole family are human doctors, and that's not always the right path for everybody. So I think what I would say is I would really have to know what makes, like, I can't say categorically that I would tell all of my kids yes or none of my, you know what I mean? Like, I think it would all be based on their personalities. I mean, I joke with my sister all the time that I should have been an orthodontist, but, like, you know, just because.
That's the worst, Sam. Ugh. Does that.
I mean, I don't know.
I hate teeth. That's, like, literally my nightmare.
No, I don't know. I think it really depends on your ability to handle stress. Because I don't think I realize how much anxiety does come along with our job. Like, I guess I always figured, like, once you had the training, you would sort of just trust yourself. And it's odd to both be very confident and also very anxious about how everything's going to turn out. Like, it's a very odd dichotomy that I definitely, that is a struggle for me for sure.
Yeah, I agree. It's a difficult balance with all the things. And I think I handle stress pretty well for the things that I do. And, but even I have days that are, your meter's a little low, you know, and that just takes some time. And that's why it's good to have good outlets, whether it's friends, family, working out, lots of cats, you know,
Something along those animals, lines. You know, they calm your blood pressure, but I do think you have to have a support system. You have to, and you have to ask for help. And I think that's one of the other things that I really do think needs to be, we need to have safer spaces. Cause there unfortunately are stories of veterinarians reaching out for help and then being screwed because of it. So that is not, you know, we need to give people safe spaces. It's okay to not be okay all the time. And I think the stigma is still there a little bit that, like, somehow you're lacking in some sort of strength if you have anxiety or depression or something like that. And it's just not true. I think really smart people, really, really, like, you know, empathetic people have a tendency to feel things largely. And I don't, there's nothing wrong with that, you know?
Yeah. They say, yeah, some of those people are the biggest demons too. Like, that, it's, you struggle a lot. So it's,
And sometimes when you just have, you know, when you think things through in a certain way, it's hard to turn it off sometimes. And I'm going to give a little plug to Inside Out too, because I really enjoyed watching it.
This is the second time I've heard people mention this movie.
It was so good. And like, there's like a character that's called Anxiety. I don't know. I just really liked watching it because I was like, this is such a good way to explain. I loved the first one too, but I just like explaining emotions in like very tangible ways to kids and stuff like that I really, really enjoyed it. So anyway, while we're talking about mental health, I just watched
it. No, it's ironic because it's really the second time within the last like week that someone mentioned they're really excited for Inside Out 2 because they think it does a really good job of just like explaining what it does, like what mental health is, and like it's okay to have these emotions.
And if they're there to protect you, but when they're out of control, that's when they can be problematic.
Exactly. It's like we need these emotions. It's okay. And I think we all need to watch this movie as kids and then really develop that stuff. Like, that's the stuff they should be teaching in schools these days. Like, how to handle your emotions. You'll be a much more competent person in all aspects of your life. Just learn to say, like, it's okay to cry. It's okay to be stressed out. Just have an outlet for it that's safe.
Yeah, look for coping skills and actually use them. And it is really, really important. And anyway, I definitely think you should watch Inside Out too.
And for any of our listeners that are listening, send us your coping mechanisms. We'd love to hear about how you get through the day, whether it's your, you know, multiple cats or you go running or anything that you do to make your day get a little easier. We'd love to hear about it because it helps to share that with others as well.
Absolutely. And if you have any questions for us, you can always contact us at podcast@mybalto.com and give a shout out to your veterinarian, give them some love, write them a review if you think they're great, because the one thing that we can all do a better job at is remembering the things that we're really good at and focusing on the things we did well in a day. Because I do think the other part of being a perfectionist is that we like to focus on the things we didn't do well. And you probably did many more things well. And so to all the veterinarians out there, you guys are doing great. Keep working hard, but enjoy it. Find the gratitude. Give yourself a break. And ask for help if you need it, because there's definitely people there to help you. And have a support system if you can.
Couldn't say it better myself. So I'll finish with that.
Thanks everyone for listening.